This is the Old Time Gospel Hour, program number 399, regular version.
That mammoth antenna is directed towards the Pentagon, and it is fixed atop the Russian embassy here in Washington, D.C. Obviously intended to pick up classified information from the Pentagon and the White House. You'll notice that building has closed shutters, and if you walk very close to the sidewalk in front of the Russian embassy, you'll find their cameras and microphones. That building represents the Soviet Union here in the United States. And typical of the Soviet Union, it is very, very secretive. The difference between the Soviet Union and the United States is the difference between slavery and freedom. It is my conviction that America cannot survive the 1980s as a free nation, that we're going to fall in subservience to the hammer and the sickle, the Soviet Union, unless we have a spiritual awakening. Their military might is unquestionably superior to ours. And their goals have never changed since 1917, the Bolshevik Revolution. Best stated by Mr. Khrushchev when he said many years ago, "We will bury you." Will they bury us? Is that in fact the destiny of these United States? Or is there a way out? We're looking for 1 million persons who will stand in the gap and pray with us because we believe 2 Chronicles 7:14. If we meet God's conditions, he said, "I'll heal your land." This is the Wake Up America Crusade series, 5 weeks of what America needs if America is to be saved during the 1980s. Yes, that's the Russian embassy. People in Russia are enslaved. We're still free here in America. And that's why as we join the service at the Thomas Road Church, we can still worship uninhibited and unharassed.
From the auditorium of the Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, the faith partners and friends bring you Jerry Falwell and the Old Time Gospel Hour.
Thank you, audience. You may be seated. Dr. Falwell, our pastor.
Stand up for Jesus. What is the hope for America? Can we survive the spread of godless communism to our shores? Can we, during this decade of destiny, the 1980s, survive as a free nation? I believe that 2 Chronicles 7:14 is the answer. And on this Faith Partner Sunday, when many of our faith partners are here from across the nation, we want to say to you in this auditorium and to millions watching by television, it's either revival, spiritual awakening, national repentance, or it's national ruin, permanent ruin. I'm believing God for the former, revival. I'm believing God for a new beginning for our country, a new birth, a rebirth during this year, 1980, and this decade in front of us. Admiral Jeremiah Denton, who was 7 years and 7 months, a POW, a prisoner of the Viet Cong, there in Hanoi, will be participating today, telling you what the difference is between the United States and the Soviet Union. He'll be telling you if, in fact, America has any hope for recovery. He'll be telling you what his message for America is. We're glad that you're here today, and I'm speaking to you today on what it means to be born free. Right now, the Liberty Baptist College Concert Choir, led by Mr. Kemrenus, sings 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people,
if my people
Thank you, choir. The answer then is revival. God said, if you'll do four things, I'll do three things. If you'll humble yourselves and pray and seek my face and turn from your wicked ways, those four things. And he asked that of us. God said, I will then hear from heaven. I will forgive your sin. I will heal your land. And he alone can do it. The hope for America does not lie with the politicians. It does not lie with Republicans or Democrats or re-electing present officials or stopping the election or the re-election of present officials. It does not exist or does not consist of putting together a new plan among economists and those who are interested in conserving energy. The hope for America, the only hope for America and for the free world, for that matter, is a spiritual awakening, a return to God. And as we shall hear next week from Senator Jesse Helms, if America survives, it will be because we have a spiritual awakening and because we fall in love with our Lord all over again. Mac Evans is coming right now to sing the song that ought to be the testimony of every one of us here today. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. I hope that's true in your life.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, is now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and hath purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. And if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
The next 10 years, without question, will be crucial years for this country. We are in a freedom crisis, we're in a family crisis, we're in a leadership crisis, and survival is the name of the game. You know, the freedom is the basic moral issue of them all. No one in Afghanistan today is talking about abortion, pornography, homosexuality. In Afghanistan and in other enslaved parts of this world, they're talking about survival, they're talking about existence, they're talking about freedom. You and I happen to possess freedom, freedom that no one else in the world enjoys, right here in North America. But if we survive this decade, I think we've got to learn some principles. I mean, the people of God have got to learn these principles. We have put together what we call a survival kit. This is that survival kit. We have written it so that every American who cares, we're trying to put together 1 million Americans, who love God, who stand in the gap. Americans who are willing to pay the price to turn this nation around. Remember the story of Sodom and Gomorrah? God said, if I can find 10 righteous persons, I'll not destroy those wicked cities steeped in homosexuality. God could not find those 10 righteous persons, and so the two cities were destroyed. Right now, we're looking for 1 million Americans, 1 million righteous persons who will pray, who will meet God's conditions. And if you'll be one of those 1 million responsible for turning this nation around, I'll send you this survival kit. Let me tell you what's inside. Inside this survival kit is a booklet entitled, Here's How You Can Help Save America. Here's how you can help save America. You say, what can I do? Well, there are certain biblical principles that are clear. One of them is the church must repent on behalf of the sins of the nation. Yes, that's exactly right. We repent for the nation's sins. Another step is intercessory prayer. And there are many scriptures given here to tell you what kind of prayer to pray. Nehemiah chapter 1 is a prayer that the great man of God prayed for Israel. And all through this book, there is the necessary information to give you the steps of action that can help you turn this nation around. And I believe if God can find 1 million righteous persons in America, He'll spare us. Doesn't matter how weak we are militarily, although that's a matter of great concern. If God be for us, who can be against us? And I want you to have the survival kit. Also inside the survival kit is a prayer for America. It's a scriptural prayer because it comes right out of Nehemiah chapter 1, where the man of God prayed for Israel, prayed for Jerusalem, and God answered that prayer. Inside also is this little packet that has in it the Old Glory flag pen, the one that I'm wearing right now. And this is that Old Glory flag pen. We'd like for you to have it, and we'll send it to you. All you need to do is ask for the survival kit. Also, there's a Bible guidance wheel. And this Bible guidance wheel is designed for you to turn and find the scriptural answers to the questions that are bothering you in these difficult times. In addition, there is a flag decal for you just to put up anywhere to remind you to pray for America every day. I call this the survival kit, and I'd like to send it to you. I'm going into prime time, as a matter of fact, right now, across America, and for the last 2 weeks, we've been in prime time with a special entitled, America, You're Too Young to Die. We began the program at President Kennedy's grave, and then we began to look out over Washington and say, here's a nation 204 years old. Like that 46-year-old president who was too young to die, our nation is too young to die, and yet we are dying, and we're the hope of the world. What can we do about it? I'm delivering the message. I have senators, congressmen, governors, great leaders who are standing with me on that program saying, here is the hope, and here's what we must do. I want the whole nation to hear it. 96% of all Americans watch television in prime time. That's why we've had to expend the money, hundreds of thousands of dollars, and that's why I'm asking my friends everywhere, when you write for the survival kit, to be one of 1 million persons who will stand with us in these difficult times, I'm asking you to enclose a gift to help us pay for that prime time in these 5 weeks of Wake Up America Crusade. Several million dollars are being expended during these 5 weeks. Make your check payable to the Old Time Gospel Hour and write to me here in Lynchburg, Virginia, and say, Jerry, send me the survival kit. And I'll send it to you with all the items that I've mentioned. And say, Jerry, here is my check. Here is my gift to help you in prime time and through 5 weeks of radio and television over the regular Old Time Gospel Hour network to tell the nation what the hope is, how this nation can come back to God. And I wish you'd write me now. Make your check payable to the Old Time Gospel Hour. It's tax deductible. It's an investment in freedom. It's an investment in your nation. It's an investment in your children and your children's children. My wife and I have 3 children. 17, 15, and 13. I want them to know the America I've known. And I think this survival kit, if a million people will enter into this personally, can give you the answer to how God can turn this nation around. And I want you to be one of 1 million. One of 1 million. I want you to write me right now and ask for the survival kit. And when you write, enclose as large a gift as you can, because the money is already spent, most of it, for this campaign and the primetime special, and we need your financial help right now. And send as generous a gift as you can. If you live in Canada, it's Box 505, Richmond Hill, Ontario. I believe if the United States survives, Canada survives, vice versa. If we fall, North America falls. We must stand together in prayer. America, you're too young to die. That's the name of the primetime special, and I want you to write me here in Lynchburg, Virginia, and say, Jerry, here is my gift, here is my investment. Make it payable to the Old Time Gospel Hour and help us with our Wake Up America Crusade. And no matter how much you send or how little you send, if you ask for the survival kit, you'll get it. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is the greatest fact of history. We serve a risen Savior. That's the difference between communism and Christianity. Communism is godless atheism. It offers no hope. It represents and approaches humanity as nothing more than animal creatures. We believe that God put us here and that God has a plan for our lives and an eternity with Him for us to spend together if we come by way of the cross and the empty tomb of Christ. So Christianity and communism, diametrically opposed. The real controversy in the world today, then, is Christ versus Satan. And for that reason, my dear friend, it's important that we understand and appreciate the doctrine of the resurrection of Christ from the dead. He's alive, so we have life in Christ. If you look in the faces of the people of Russia, godless Russia, there's just a hopeless, dark, pitiful look. You look into the faces of what I'm seeing right now, thousands of Christians here today, there's joy, there's hope, there's love. And right now, the Old Time Gospel Hour trio is going to sing about the resurrection of Christ.
Nails in my hand, laugh at me where you stand. Oh, go ahead and say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see, 'cause I arrive. Still be the same. Oh, go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will be free, 'cause I'll rise again. There's no power on earth can tie me down. Go ahead.
but you will see that you were all wrong. Oh, go ahead and try to hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one, 'cause I'll come again.
There's no power on earth can keep me back.
Yes, I'll come again.
Come to take my people back.
Yes, I'll come again.
Come to take my people back.
Jesus is alive. And I would say to every communist in the world, and any watching this program right now, if you'll believe that Christ died for your sins according to the Scriptures, that Jesus Christ was buried for you, that He rose again the third day for your justification, you can have the forgiveness of sins and a home in heaven forever. Because God so loved the world, and that includes you. That includes you. That includes you. That includes everyone. I personally believe that if somehow the gospel doors were opened in Russia and Red China and Cuba, and missionaries and preachers could go in, and those godly men who are already there but who are oppressed could come out from the underground and preach, I believe there'd be a sweeping revival. Because I believe there's a spiritual hunger in the communist world today. We need to pray for the salvation of the hundreds of millions behind the Iron Curtain and the Bamboo Curtain. In Acts chapter 22, page 1642 in the Faith Partner Bible, reading verses 25 through 29, Paul was enslaved. He was in chains. Why? Because of preaching the gospel. He'd been warned not to go to Jerusalem, but he went anyhow. And as he went to Jerusalem, he found open hearts on the part of the saints. He found closed doors and many adversaries on the part of the religionists and the Antichrist people of that day. They took him prisoner. He later, as you know, went to Rome, where he was beheaded for the gospel's sake. But in Acts 22, verses 25 through 29, we read some powerful words spoken by Paul in his own defense. And as they bound him with thongs, Paul said unto the centurion that stood by, "Is it lawful for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned?" When the centurion heard that, he went and told the chief captain, saying, "Take heed what thou doest, for this man is a Roman." Then the chief captain came and said unto him, "Tell me, art thou a Roman?" He said, "Yea." And the chief captain answered, "With a great sum obtained I this freedom." And Paul said, "But I was freeborn." Then straightway they departed from him which should have examined him. And the chief captain also was afraid, after he knew that he was a Roman, and because he had bound him. Right now, we're going to have a man come to lead us in prayer who has held two evangelistic crusades in this church. His name is Evangelist Freddie Gage. In the first crusade, 431 souls were saved. In the second one, 850 souls were saved. There were over 3,000 different decisions for Christ in those two campaigns. He's an associate evangelist with James Robison. The James Robison Crusades in Fort Worth, Texas, where you can contact Freddie. He is conducting Go Tell Crusades right now in churches all over America. And I recommend his ministry to every pastor in church. Freddie, would you come? And if you'd like to say a word before you pray, feel free to do that. Evangelist Freddie Gage.
Thank you, Jerry. It's been exciting to be on the campus of Liberty Baptist College here in Lynchburg, Virginia, to see patriotic young people who are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I personally believe if America is spared, if we have a revival in this country, and America experiences a genuine Holy Ghost revival, Liberty Baptist College will make the history books if Jesus delays his coming. The James Robison Ministries believe that Liberty Baptist College is one of the most outstanding Bible colleges in America. We support and praise God for Liberty Baptist College. Why are we so strong for Liberty Baptist College? Every professor is a personal soul winner. Every student is a witness. You find no liberals on the campus here at Liberty Baptist College. They preach and believe in personal soul winning. As the famous preacher R.G. Lee once said, one soul is worth a million worlds. They believe that. They believe, as Billy Sunday preached and taught, the gospel isn't something to come to church to hear. It's something to go from the church to tell. They believe in the inerrancy of the Word of God. And I challenge you across America to get involved in this great college and pray for the students here that God has anointed to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're not all preachers, but they're all reachers sharing Him. Amen. And as John Wesley taught his students, he told his students, you have one purpose and mission on earth, and that is to save souls. And that's the heartbeat, the Alpha and the Omega of Liberty Baptist College in Lynchburg, Virginia. And I pray today that you'll catch a vision of what God is doing in this great college. Shall we pray? Father, we realize that it's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by thy Spirit. Amen. We pray the Holy Spirit will convict, the Holy Spirit will convert, the Holy Spirit shall bring multitudes to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I pray for every student on this campus. I pray for a special anointing upon their life. And fathers, they take the gospel to the four ends of the world. I pray they shall be a torch to save this country from communism and for our moral deterioration. Father, we pray today, as Dr. Falwell preaches, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost of God to breathe upon him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Freddie. The Apostle Paul was imprisoned. He was en route to martyrdom. He was a preacher of the gospel, but he lived during the days of the great Roman Empire. During this time when his captors were about to scourge and mistreat him, they had bound him, he asked them, is it lawful for you to manhandle a Roman? And immediately everybody stood back. And one of the leaders came and said, are you really a Roman? Yes, I am. The chief captain said, it cost me a great deal of money, this freedom that I have. How did you get yours? And his answer was, I was freeborn. On August 11, 1933, in Campbell County near Lynchburg, Virginia, I was born an American, born free. And for these past 46 years, I've never had to get up in the morning wondering if my telephone was tapped, wondering if someone would be knocking on the door to come and take my parents away or my family away or me. I've never had to be afraid since I came into the ministry to preach the gospel and to tell it like it is for fear that some government agent might walk in the back door and take me away. Thank God for freedom. Well, Paul was freeborn. You and I in the USA and Canada are freeborn. What does that mean? If we happened to live in Russia today, we'd know the difference. William Simon, in his book, A Time for Truth, tells how that he and another, a group of governmental officials had gone to Moscow on government business. If you've read A Time for Truth, you know about this. And it's the testimony of millions who know something about communism. He said, from the time we arrived in Russia, there was a different feeling, a different atmosphere. I knew every moment, everything I was saying was being overheard. Everything I was doing was being seen by somebody somewhere. When I sat down to dine with the Russian officials, I looked in their faces and I thought, you men know nothing of freedom. You've been slaves all of your life. And finally, he said, on that day when we all inside the big airplane lifted off the airport at Moscow and the sound of the wheels locking up into the airplane were heard, there was a spontaneous outburst of applause. Everybody on board began to applaud. Why? Because they had escaped slavery, communism. I said this to a Russian official once when we were talking about America and Russia. And he was telling me all the merits of Soviet communism, and I was telling him about America. And I said, you know, I have an experiment I'd like to suggest to you, which if you will pull off successfully, I'll become a Marxist. And it's this. I want you to convince the Politburo, Mr. Brezhnev, those in authority, to announce that 30 days from this announcement, we will allow anyone who wishes to leave the Soviet Union to do so. We have arranged with the United States of America and other free nations to take an unlimited quota of Soviet citizens. But you must leave during those 24 hours, and anyone who wishes to leave may do so without danger. I said, if you'll do that and give them 30 days to get prepared and get organized, in my opinion, when those 24 hours of exodus are over, there'll be no one left in the Soviet Union but Mr. and Mrs. Brezhnev, and she may leave. Now, the question is, if it's so good, why do you build walls around it to keep people in while we develop quotas to keep people out? The fact is that communism is bad news. They murdered 142 million people since 1917, the Bolshevik Revolution. 142 million people have been slain by the communists, the Leninists, the Marxists to accomplish their horrible ends. What is the goal of communism? It's world conquest. There's no question about it. Can godlessness, aggressive communism, coexist with peaceful Christianity? Not unless we're willing to pay the price. Not unless we're willing to be properly defensed. Not unless we're willing to be strong. Not unless we're willing to pay the price for freedom. Edmund Burke said, all that is necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing. And that is what America has been doing for the last 30 years. Nothing. The time has come for leaders in America, pastors and educators and military leaders and political leaders and business leaders. The time has come for the leaders of America to stand up against the spread of this godless monster that has engulfed more than half the world since 1917. I know that one is accused of being a witch hunter when he begins talking about this subject, but I've watched Afghanistan fall, Angola, Rhodesia. I've watched all this happen the last few months, and I've watched that red spread across the globe, the planet, and I see that the free world is ever diminishing, and we're a tiny part of that free world, and we seem to have no resolve, no will, no commitment to win. Recently, I was standing in Arlington National Cemetery in Washington, D.C. There were tombstones all around, the symbol of the sacrifice that millions of Americans have paid in the past 200-plus years to guarantee us this religious freedom. I was standing there with Admiral Jeremiah Denton, Behind us was the Pentagon, the military nerve center of this nation. Admiral Denton was shot down on a bombing mission over North Vietnam. He was 7 years and 7 months in a prison camp, 4 years in solitary confinement, and during those 4 years of solitary confinement, he was not allowed to speak one word, not one. He had 2 years in which he could whisper to a cellmate. I believe that Admiral Denton is one of the heroes of our day. I ask him some very pointed questions. Admiral, I'd like for you, as a military man, and a Christian, of course, to distinguish as you see it, Soviet communism, world communism, and the United States of America and what we stand for. What's the difference between Russia and the United States, for example?
Well, there's 6 national principles, the first one being belief in God, one nation under God. They have the opposite. They have atheism as a part of their official dogma. All the rest of our principles flow from that belief in God. Family is the second one. The basic structure, the basic fabric of our society is the family. Theirs is supposed to be the commune. The third is free enterprise, the driver of our progress, moderated by Christian compassion. Theirs is the opposite, communism as an economic system. Fourth, we have our sense of citizens' rights, which was derived in our declaration as from the statement endowed by our creator. Well, we're forgetting our creator, and we're forgetting the nature of those rights, and we're going for instant self-gratification. In the Soviet Union, there's very little sense of rights toward the government. Then the fifth one would be our sense of obligation toward our government, which I believe is diminishing. Theirs is very strong still, and therein lies a great disadvantage for us. Lastly, our international orientation is the opposite of theirs. We are basically altruistic toward the rest of the world. Imperfect record, but you ask any foreigner about history, and he'll say the United States has done more good worldwide than anybody else, and the Soviet Union has done a great deal of harm. They're devoted to conquest of the entire world by violent revolution. Those are the 6 basic principles. We're forgetting principles. If you look at the strategic pyramid upon which those principles bear, the survival is the same national vital national interest of each. The objectives of the Soviet Union and of us are analogous. The policies are analogous. The commitments are analogous. It's the principles which differentiate us. We're forgetting our principles. We're forgetting the source of our strength. We are becoming weak. We could become one of the nations strewn in history as part of the historical graveyard, and that building could be rendered helpless, not by virtue of its lack of physical strength, but by our lack of spiritual strength.
Admiral, do you feel that the Soviet Union is committed to overthrow this nation, the United States of America?
There's no question about it, and I think she's making very good progress right now.
Do you think then it's a mistake for us to feel that in recent days, during times of Dayton, etc., that their attitude towards world conquest has changed at all?
I think it is a great mistake. I believe we should start teaching comparative politics, the very differences you and I are discussing, in the first grade in the United States of America, in terms that they can understand. A first grader can understand the difference between being able to be free to go where he wants, to say what he wants, to go to church where he wants, to worship God the way he wishes. They can understand that. They should be told that. How can you become 18 years old without having learned what's that difference and only be conscious of what is wrong in this country, which you see every day on television, every day in the newspapers, all picking away at an imperfect but best system? How can you vote intelligently at 18 and be willing to serve your country at risk of your life without knowing those basic facts? They learn those comparative politics in Russia with lies. We need to learn the truth starting in the first grade.
Admiral, here's a question that you may not want to answer, but I think the American public wants to know. Do you think it is too late for America? Do you think that this country can recover? Are we down the pike forever? Or is there hope that we can again become a nation, a great nation under God?
Practically, I don't know. We're a long way down the pike. San Francisco looks more like Sodom and Gomorrah than a city of one nation under God. Theoretically, reading the Bible and remembering when the Lord said he would not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, were there 10 just men left in those cities, I believe we can survive. We have a lot more than 10 left, men, women, and children in this nation. And I believe that if we, alerted as we are now, can come to the awareness that it's spiritual weakness, not physical weakness, although we have both, we can save this country.
Admiral, if you had just one or two sentences to deliver to the American public regarding the way back, the hope for our future, what would you say?
Try to live up to being one nation under God. Have the courage to back with commitment the principles to saving our nation against the threat of communism and against the threat of the deterioration of the family as an institution in the United States. To me, those are the two biggest threats to our survival today.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
This is a nation under God. Admiral Denton is right. And if we do not come back to that position of one nation under God, it's going to be too late. Let's talk about freeborn. What does it mean to be freeborn? First of all, it means that I can worship God according to the dictates of my heart. I do not appreciate the doctrine of Madeleine Murray O'Hare. She has a very obnoxious doctrine. It's called atheism. But I would die for her right to preach her doctrine, because the same Constitution that gives her that right gives me this right. I do not agree with many of the cults who are preaching. I go through the airports and the little Moonies are passing out the flowers. I abhor the doctrine of the Moonies. Anything that takes children away from their parents is bad news. But I want to say to you that I'm very, very cautious in suggesting limiting anyone's religious liberties. The Constitution grants to all of us the right to worship God as we please. Can you do that in Russia today? Of course not. If you go on a trip to the Soviet Union, they'll take you through some churches in Moscow, window dressing. There's some real genuine people there. I don't mean that. But they allow these churches to operate reluctantly only because they want the tourists to think there's religious freedom in Russia. Ask them for 2 days off the tour to go where you want to go and talk to anybody you want to talk to. You'll never be granted that. Because the fact is, when you go into the mainland of Russia, you'll find the churches are closed, the Christians are suppressed and persecuted, as has been the case since 1917. Red China's the same way. God's at work there in spite of all the oppression. God is moving because he's greater than communism. But I'm saying they do not have religious liberty. And that's true in Cuba. That's true in East Germany. That's true in Eastern European nations. That's true in the Asian nations where communism now rules. And don't let anybody propagandize you that that isn't the case. If Russian communism ever overtakes this nation, if the hammer and the sickle ever goes up over the stars and stripes, the preachers like myself will be the first to go. And churches like this one will be closed down just like that. What's the difference? Religious freedom. Isn't it great to come here and preach the gospel, talk into a microphone, look into a camera, and tell millions of people that Jesus died for your sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. He rose again for your salvation. And if you'll trust him as your Savior, he'll keep you out of hell. He'll give you a life worth living right now. You can't do that in Russia. You can do it here. That's the difference. What else is different about being freeborn and born in slavery? The difference is that I have, as an individual, privileges and dignity that is not true in the communist world. I have the right to decide if I wish to be a businessman, to buy property, because in this nation, one can own property. Let me tell you something about socialism and communism. They're anti-biblical. The free enterprise system has its roots in the book of Proverbs. And the right to own property is a God-given right. Here in America, I can purchase property. I can build a house on it and take my wife and children into that house. I can build a business. I can, in the free enterprise system, compete. And with initiative, I can be successful. I'll tell you something else about this wonderful system of ours as compared to the Soviet Union. I can disagree with the government. I can disagree with my president, with the Congress, with the judiciary, and not go to jail for it. If Alexander Solzhenitsyn were standing here today, he would tell you that isn't true in Russia. That's why he lives in the United States today. If the Baptist pastor, Georgie Venz, who will be here during our super conference later this year, were standing here, he would tell you, you can't do that in Russia. That's why he now lives in the United States. And millions have died because they dared to dissent. They dared to disagree with the government. We're visiting all 50 state capitals with I Love America rallies. We meet on the steps. The governors join us there. We'll be in 3 of them this week, traveling several thousand miles. I'll stand there, and here's the governor, and here are the senators and the representatives and hundreds of pastors and thousands of people. We'll have 20,000 people on the steps tomorrow of the state capitol of our next meeting. And I'll stand there and take issue with these men on things like abortion, homosexuality, pornography, the dignity of the traditional family in America. They may totally disagree with me, but I can say all of that and nothing is done about it. Why? Because this is America. This is still the land of the free and the home of the brave. And we have the constitutional right to assemble peaceably and to redress our grievances. And no one can stop us from doing that. How wonderful that is. Let Jane Fonda try that in the Kremlin. You let her go to the Kremlin and say about their government what she comes here and says about ours. You let Betty Friedan and Gloria Steinem and others say the things they say in the Soviet Union. You let those who hate this nation, and there are many who do, you let those persons who disagree with government here try that in Peking, Havana, Moscow. The earth will swallow them up. I'd say to all of those of you who gave comfort to the Viet Cong during the Vietnam conflict, those of you who marched against the government and brought shame on the military, I would say to you, this is the greatest nation on earth. With all of our imperfections, you ought to thank God that you live in America. This is a free country. We're freeborn. What else does it mean? In closing, it means that I have the privilege and the right to evangelize. Did you know that if you go to a country like the Soviet Union, like China, like Cuba, like the Muslim countries, with pockets filled with gospel tracts in the language of the people, and a Bible in your hand, and begin to preach the gospel, lead people to Jesus, start a church, you know what will happen to you? You'll either be imprisoned or killed. Why? Because evangelization is not allowed in those countries that are enslaved. In America, I looked up the street the other day. 2 boys were coming down the street on bicycles. They were Mormons. White shirt and tie, knocking on door after door. I was on the porch waiting for them to stop at my house, but they didn't. I respect their diligence, by the way. And I was talking to a Mormon elder later from Utah, and I said, listen, I saw 2 of your boys coming down my street the other day where I live, knocking on the doors of my people. But I want you to know we have a boy out in Utah right now, one of our graduates. We're paying his way to start a Bible-believing, soul-winning, fundamentalist church. And he's knocking on the doors of your people right now. I would die for the right of your boys to come down my street, and I would hope that you'd die for the right of my boy to go down your street. Amen. That's what America's all about. Amen. We don't have to agree with each other, but brother, America means that we have the right to evangelize, and nobody can do anything about it. When I hear in the state of Maryland that some religious hoodlums up there in government have outlawed the distribution of Gideon Bibles in the school system of Maryland, I say that's unconstitutional. And every one of you in Maryland ought to ring their bell. They're not going to do that in Virginia. And I want to say to you that all over this nation, we need to stand up for religious freedom, the right to evangelize. I mean everybody's rights, not just ours, theirs too. But that's what America's all about, and that's the difference between the Soviet Union and the United States of America. And that's why I thank God I live here. I pray for the Soviet citizens. They're just poor lost sinners who, if they were given a chance to hear the gospel, they'd respond like anybody else. I think more readily because they've been oppressed long enough to know that's a bad news system. That's also true in China, and that's true all over the communist world. And we need to pray that God will open the doors and help us through radio and television and missionaries somehow to get back in there with a message and pray for the saints who are there. But I thank God that I can stand here and say what I've said today, and there are no soldiers walking in the back door after me. That may happen in this decade if America doesn't stand up for Jesus, if we don't take it 2 Chronicles 7:14 to heart, if we as a nation do not repent of our sins. I'm speaking of the church repenting for the sins of the nation. This nation may go down the tubes in the 1980s. Let's pray. While our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I'd like to ask you a question there sitting in the pew or by the television set. If you are not a Christian, if you've never been born again, if you were going to die in the next 5 minutes and you knew it, and you don't know that you'd go to heaven, I'd like to pray for you. Jesus died for you. He was buried for you. He rose from the dead for you. And I wish that every one of you sitting there in the pew and looking into this television screen right now, if you're not sure you're saved, if you're not sure you're ready to meet God, will you just bow your head right now and pray this prayer? God, have mercy upon me, a sinner, and save me for Christ's sake. Ask Jesus to come into your heart. Invite him in as your Savior and Lord. And if you'll do that, God will save you right where you are. If you'll write to me, if you've made that decision for Christ, I'll send you a free copy of my booklet entitled How to Get Started Right. If you are not sure you're saved and you want one of my pastors to call you, J.O. Grooms or one of the soul winning pastors will call you at our expense and discuss salvation with you. We have scores saved every week that way. Just write me. If you have a prayer request, a personal need or burden or heartache, and you'd like for us to pray with you and for you, send your prayer request to me and Bill Sheehan and the prayer team will pray for you by name and we'll write you personally. Could we all stand to pray? While every head is bowed and every eye is closed, how many of you in this auditorium can say, Jerry, I'm saved, I know I'm saved. If I die in the next 5 minutes, I'm as sure for heaven as if I were already there. Would you raise your hand, please? God bless you. How many of you will say, I have a spiritual need of some kind? I am a Christian, but I'm not living as close to God as I ought to. I'm not a soul winner. I'm not a witness. Pray for me. Raise your hand. God bless every one of you. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, in the precious name of Jesus, because you died upon a cross, because you were buried, because you rose again from the dead, save those souls nearest hell. Reclaim backsliders. Meet the need of every heart and every life. I pray in Jesus' name and for Jesus' sake. Amen. While our heads are still bowed and eyes are closed, upstairs and down, I want every man, woman, boy, girl in this auditorium who says, I need to get saved, I want you to step out and come down here. Every one of you who needs to rededicate your life to the Lord, I want you to come and have prayer with us. If you want to unite with our church, I invite you to come. Whatever your need may be, whatever the spiritual need of your heart is, right now, while heads are bowed and Christians are praying, will you come? Just step out and come. Amen. Amen.
You have been watching the Old Time Gospel Hour, originating from the Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia. If you would like an audio cassette of today's program, please write to Jerry Falwell, Lynchburg, Virginia, 24514, and enclose a $4 donation. Request program number 399. To become a faith partner and receive this beautiful faith partner Bible, call toll-free 1-800-453-1900 for complete information. Once again, that toll-free number is 1-800-453-1900. Now, this is John Corrigan inviting you to join us next week for another telecast of the Old Time Gospel Hour. Until then, may God richly bless you, is our prayer. The preceding has been an LBC Television Network presentation.
US 535 U.S. senators and representatives perform the legislative business of this country in that building, the U.S. Capitol. 230 million Americans have the responsibility of holding this nation together through prayer. This is a nation under God. We believe that unless this country returns to moral sanity during the 1980s and very soon, that we will not, as Senator Helms said, deserve to survive. I'm asking you to write me here in Lynchburg and help us with our primetime special, America, You're Too Young to Die. Help us place it in those time slots where the nation will hear what I believe to be the vital message for this hour. And everyone who writes will be sending to you the survival kit. Inside this kit, information, as you know, helpful to you as a citizen to help this nation return to those basic principles of morality so important to us today.